to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing. I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing.
Come on, you say.
Songs that will help us, amen, especially as befitting in the times that we are living in. This Thursday, we will be back in Bible class. We had a half an hour teleconference on last Thursday about the word thug. Somebody say thug. Our nation and our world is definitely in an unrest position. And it's several things that's going on around the world that we need to be conscious of and aware of. Thursday we'll be back and then sharing some of the things that we discussed last Thursday. I do want to say this, I'm a firm believer that incident in Baltimore was not just about Mr. Gray's death.
Amen.
It was more deeper than that.
Amen.
We have several things that are going on where injustice is happening, but God has the final say.
That's right.
Of everything. The Proverbs, the third chapter this morning, and I said Proverbs, but I believe that's not Proverbs, that's Ecclesiastic. Help me. I didn't get the audio. I wrote the wrong. Ecclesiastic, the third chapter, and then Matthew's, the fourth chapter. Ecclesiastic, write this particular one down. I won't be able to preach all of this today in a timely manner. Ecclesiastes, third chapter, verse 1-8, and Matthew's, the fourth chapter, verse 1-2. If you have those two passages of scripture, you will stand to your feet. We reverence the reading and hearing of the word of the Lord. I'm going to ask you to help me out in reading this morning. Ecclesiastes, the third chapter, verse 1-8, and then Matthew's, the fourth chapter, verse 1-2. If you haven't, say amen.
Amen.
Let's begin with Ecclesiastes 3, 1-8. Begin. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven. Come on, read.
A time to be born.
Uh-huh.
A time to die.
Yes.
A time to plan.
Uh-huh.
A time to unknow. That which is planned.
Uh-huh.
A time to heal.
Uh-huh.
A time to heal.
Yes. 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 Together. Yes. 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 Yes.
And a time to speak.
Yes.
And a time to love.
Uh-huh.
And a time to hate. And a time of war.
Uh-huh.
And a time of peace.
Let's be read verse 1 again. Yes. And the church says, Matthew's in the New Testament. Number 4, 4th chapter, verses 1 and 2. Matthew's the 4th chapter, verse 1 and 2. You have it? Say amen.
Amen.
Let's begin. Then Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Yes, read.
And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights,
He
was asked by the Lord.
And the church says,
amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you, God, even this day that you allowed us the opportunity to realize that there are seasons in everything that we deal with. And nothing just happens, even in the wilderness experience. And God, we ask you to help us, oh God, as we decrease. You increase mightily. You speak to the people of God. This we ask in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Our soul says, amen. Before you sit down, look at your name, say, neighbor. Your season
for
blessings,
is
on the way.
On the way.
Come on, tell them again, say,
neighbor.
Your season
for
blessings,
is
on the way.
On the way.
You may be seated in the presence of God. Your season is on the way.
Yes.
Even during bloody times, even during the times of destruction, even during chaotic and crucial and ugly times, it is evident that we have a season of blessings that are on the way. It's important. We've just experienced winter, and we have, I thought, was a cold winter this year. Regardless of weather, we are here in Maryland, D.C. area. I think we haven't really experienced any snow, but you got some people that are in the United States that can testify that they got some snow this year.
Amen.
We got some cold, cold, cold weather that we haven't received in a long time like that, back to back. And it was exciting to know that sooner or later that snow and that coldness would disappear. Now, you observing the weather, it seemed like you go out one day and it's 80 degrees. You come back the next day, it's like about 30 or 40. It's hard to determine what season we're in.
Amen.
But some kind of way we recognize winter season. I know that there are four seasons, and they taught me in school that there's winter, spring, summer, and fall. And they taught me that seasons generally follow that trend. It goes from winter to spring, from spring to summer, and then from summer to fall. And then the cycle starts all over again. If you've lived on this earth any length of time, you've probably experienced all four of those seasons. And if you lived on earth any length of time and don't realize that you experienced those four seasons, then I surmise that there's something wrong with you. Hello, somebody. Because as long as I've been living, we've seen those kind of things take place. Winter, spring, summer, and fall. During the winter season, sometimes it's difficult to deal with. Deal with it. This term winter, as a Christian, you can take this particular term winter, and you can almost use it interchangeably with wilderness and or valley experience. Some of our winter experiences or wilderness experience or valley experience are always not the best experience. You know, when you in the winter and it's cold and it's icy, you seem like you're all alone sometimes. You ever get in the house because they told you you can't go to school, and you're in the house and you really want to do something and you can't do nothing because you're in the house. Somebody help me here. That's like almost they say like almost being locked up in a cave. Come on, y'all, help me somebody. Well, let's talk about the winter experience and let's talk about the wilderness and valley experience. Right. As we look at our nation, we see that in Baltimore that there were some disturbance going on. And several things precipitated and caused that those disturbances to go on. And it's amazing how the news so quickly wanted to report all of the negativity about what was going on. Hardly but few could view and see something good that was, or talk about something good that was going on. My understanding is that there were peaceful,
that's right.
There were peaceful rallies going on all week long. And during those peaceful rallies that were led by groups that had the best interest of the city at hand, the best interest of the people at hand, did not get the publicity.
That's right.
Somebody help me in this place. Did not get the coverage like we got all over the nation.
Amen.
All eyes were on Baltimore.
All eyes.
I was there, and I was talking to some high officials about the things, the disturbance that was going on. They categorized it and called it a riot. Mm-hmm. And the talk and the discussion similarly led towards what our discussion on the phone Thursday night was all about thugs. And it prompted me to ask the question about thugs. Somebody say thugs. And sometimes our behavior is categorized. Young people, you may not like being called certain things, but if your behavior dictates certain things, certain kind of ways, you're going to be called what your behavior dictates.
Exactly.
Doesn't necessarily mean you a thug.
There you go.
But your action,
sorry,
is thuggish. Somebody help me. I'm not overly concerned about individuals that are thugs. Somebody help me. Because I can go in the scripture and I can get you a legitimate thug that's in the scripture.
Amen.
And this thug that's in the scripture, actually, if you really look at him, he was a licensed thug. He had a license to be a thug. I know y'all looking at me saying, well, you know, he was in the Ecclesiastes and he was in Matthew, and then you're talking about a thug. This thug's name was Apostle Paul.
Amen.
And he was so much of a thug that he was doing something that I would deem he was thuggish.
That's right.
Because he was hauling good folks and putting them in jail. Those that declared that they were Christians. They tell me that this Apostle Paul acquired letters to go to Damascus, to go down to get the saints, amen, that were down there preaching and teaching and talking about Jesus. And every time you began to see in this particular text about Paul, amen, he was doing thuggish things. And I would say that was in his winter seasons. That was during the time that he was in winter season. And sometimes you can be right, be legally right in what you're doing, but what you're doing could be wrong.
Amen.
You make a statement. Paul, amen, was making a statement. Amen. And his statement was backed up by the letters of authority that they gave him. But the Bible tells me that you only operate so much and so far when you deal with God. Because when God deals with you, he's going to get you straight. Mm-hmm. While Paul was on his way down to persecute the saints that was in Damascus, amen, we then find that God began to deal with Paul on that road. And when he was on that road, they tell me that he was knocked off his beast by a light. Mm-hmm. And Paul recognized that something greater than him caused him to fall to the earth. Paul began to talk and began to speak to this thing that struck him and said, "Who art thou, Lord?" Paul began to realize that it, the voice that spoke said, "It is I, it is Jesus, me, the one that you are persecuting, you're persecuting me." So, you know, Paul said, "It's hard to kick against the pricks." I just want you to see that many times when things come against us as Christians, we can't be so easy and so quick to ready to throw in the towel. Because God knows how to handle us during our winter season. God, you know, sometimes in our winter season, seem like things are dried up, things are dead, things are not going anywhere. But I'm here to let you know that you don't have to worry about it, because sooner or later, spring is on the way. All around my house, I had leaves and dead trees and dead flowers, and everything was dead. Somebody help me here. Went around yesterday and looked, and the stuff is all starting to bloom and blossom. Amen. All that winter did was it didn't kill it. Somebody help me here. Even though it looked dead, somebody say it might look dead, but it ain't dead. Your circumstance may look like it's dead, may look like it's not going anywhere, but God knows how to deal with your circumstance. Spring is coming. I'm here to let you know it ain't gonna be a winter all the time. Oh God. Well, I looked at this text and I looked at how that during the winter season, how that in Ecclesiastes Solomon said there's a time and a season for everything and every purpose under the sun. That lets me know nothing just happened because it want to happen. Nothing just happened because I think I'm going to make it happen. When God said that it's time, amen, for something to change, yeah. I can't no devil in hell stop what was going on. I looked at that and I started to take issue and start looking at the various things that had gone on in the past and the things that are going on today. And the question that hit me and Minister Dye was, and what happened to y'all guys in the 68 riots? And I hate to tell somebody that I'm a byproduct of the 68 riots. And the disturbance that went on around my neighborhood, it troubled me. Now, I wasn't like that young man that was out there in that tearing up. I was afraid.
Wow.
Okay. Help us, somebody. Can I get a few people in there? Everybody don't want to say they were afraid. Amen. You know, everybody don't talk. Because I see the young men on television and they wasn't concerned about being afraid.
Not even.
They were willing to die for the cause.
That's right.
Right? And my mind would question, well, what is the cause?
Okay.
What would cause me to tear my neighborhood up? What would cause something that almost set my house on fire.
Right.
Because it's the same community. It's the same demographics. Go back and check the Baltimore riot. Look at all of the things that went on. Look at the radius of the home of the destruction. And look and see what radius the destruction is in. The destruction was not in downtown Baltimore. Huh? The destruction was not down in the Coliseum or down at the stadium. Come on here. The harbor is still intact. Come on here, somebody. But the destruction was in our neighborhood. So you got to say to yourself about it. The news lets us know the call for, you know, that something went out on Facebook or something went out in the schools and caused young people to get and rally together. Young people, let me tell you something. If stuff go out in the school that going to cause you to do something, that they're going to put you in a situation that can possibly put you in jail for about 20 or 30 years, don't obey what they say. Come on, baby. Somebody say, yes, sir, run. You don't run with the crowd, you run away from the crowd. Yeah. Oh, God. I feel like I'm going to preach. I feel like just for a minute. Listen. You have to learn how to run away from trouble. Because the choir sang the song, trouble don't last always. We may endure for a night. But if the truth be told, took a picture of a riot that was in Venezuela and put it on the news like it was in Baltimore. In Florida, so when Minister Frazier and his family and traveling, amen. But that was Minister Frazier that was in Baltimore. And that was Keith in Baltimore. Sandra and Sean, they were our children. Because who is my neighbor?
Go ahead.
Huh? My neighbor is everybody. So our children were at the forefront of trouble.
That's right.
Yeah. I began to look at this text and I said, wow, it does look like it's a dead situation. And news are perpetrating and making it as though that we're out of control. Mm. You know, and sometimes when you get upset, you do get out of control.
That's right.
We had this lesson before. You know, you can't keep your composure when you're upset. And if you can't control yourself, you will do some things that can cause trouble in your life later on. God. And so when I looked at all of this and I looked at the winter season, and I said, Lord, what's going to happen, amen, to us, amen. And God, he began to show me that blessings is going to come up out of this thing.
Yes.
We're going to use this as a teaching moment. Somebody else's mistake.
That's right.
And if you don't want to learn from somebody else's mistake, you will repeat the same mistake.
Yeah.
I learned from somebody else's mistake. I learned that in 68, amen, that when you tear down something in your own community, it will take a while for them to build it back up. I already learned that lesson. Come on, here's something.
was burnt. They tell me, amen, that it was already boarded up. God help me. So they was accustomed to having things boarded up. Amen. But they tell me that, this pastor that was building a senior citizen home, man, and 60 homes and a work learning center and a place, amen, that can help the community. They set it on fire. See, when you're not in your right mind, you suddenly destroy the things that belong to you. That's going to work out for your good. You see? You subject to destroy yourself and the things that you're working toward that's going to better you. Oh, God. Oh, yeah. That's what you subject to destroy. When I looked at, amen, that what was going on behind the scene, you had pastors and preachers that were coming together, that wanted to, hey, mobilize together to get the young people, get their minds, amen, off of trouble and into the right direction. You can take the momentum, amen, and you can steer it in the right direction if you got the right leadership. You got some folks that are of a negative persuasion that what all you want you to do is to fight and to burn down and to tear up. I question that. Why do you want me to tear what belongs to me up? Think about all those young people. Think about somebody lived around the CVS. Somebody lived in that area, lived in that community. Think about what would happen if those houses, all of them caught on fire. And you got some people that's trying to stop the fire department from putting the fire out. Think about it. If it got out of so much control, somebody said, well, what about the mayor? The mayor could have did something. She did the right thing. I'm glad. Because all of the police officers had 9 millimeters. They had guns. They had bullets. And they could have shot everybody. Would that solve the problem? No. That just created a bigger problem. Think about it. It just looked dead. Your blessing is on the way. Your situation, it looked like it's not going to do anything. Looked like it's not going to work out. But the Bible said that all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and to them that are called according to his word, his mercy, called to his purpose. I'm telling you, it's going to work out for your good. In the book of Revelation, at the 22nd chapter, there's a tree that's on the other side of the river. That this tree, it was good. In other words, it had 12 manner of fruit that grew on it. In other words, 12 different fruits grew from this one tree. Tell me that as Christians, you ought to be able to look for some good fruit that's on your tree. Because in telling that this tree, it was good for the healing of the nation. Oh, yes, it is. So something good ought to happen out of your life. I'm telling you to learn how to experience all the good that happened. That's going to happen. Listen here. Your season for blessings, it is on the way. When you go through your winter season, you ought to look for spring to come. Hey, God. Come on here, somebody. Well, how do you get flowers to grow after being dead? Well, you got to cultivate around them. You got to put some fertilizer around them. There were going to be some dry situations. There were going to be some times when he was hungry. There were going to be some times when pride, somebody going to speak to you and tell you something that's contrary to what you do or what you should do. Listen here. When the dry situation came, they came to Jesus and they said to him, listen here. Like he was the
for you. He wasn't defeated. It just looked like it. Somebody help me here. Your situation that you're going through, it just looked like you're not going to make it. But the devil is a lie. Your season is on the way. It only looked like it.
I'm trying to build the salt. Children got the notion that they want to take their kids, their parents to court for child abuse. I want the children to know when your children and your parents go to jail, you want to foster home.
That's right. That's right. Teach Bishop. Teach Bishop.
So you ought to think twice.
There you go.
But my friend took my their parents to the court, asked their parents where did they try to get locked up? Yeah. Ask them where are they staying there.
Exactly.
So you ain't staying in that house.
That's
that
right.
Your mama paid for.
That's right.
And you ain't got no money to pay for.
Preach. No.
They just tell you, oh, no, your parents are abusing you. Just because you got a woman don't mean you're getting abused.
Go ahead.
You get what the Bible told us to do.
That's right.
Oh.
Yeah.
Preach.
Yeah. It didn't say tell us to tap you. It told us to beat you.
Yeah.
It's in the book.
And you would tell us how we beat you. Now, we're not supposed to kill our kids.
No.
Neither are we supposed to move them money when we're angry.
Yeah.
That's right.
Now,
that's right.
You that are going around saying I'm your pastor, I'm coming to get you.
To you every day.
withholding nothing, withholding nothing. I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you. Withholding nothing. Withholding.